Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I declare the fifth sitting of the 23rd session of the Conference of State Parties open. Distinguished delegates, we shall now go back to our sub-item AC, implementation of the Conference of State Parties and the Executive Council decisions on destruction-related issues. At the request of the delegation of the United States of America, we shall take this item in an open mode. Now, I'd like to invite the delegation of the United States of America to make a presentation. You have a floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director General Arias, distinguished colleagues, I am honored to have the opportunity to address this conference of the state parties and provide information on the status of the United States chemical demilitarization program. As you are well aware, the United States remains fully committed to a world free of chemical weapons, and to date, we have safely destroyed more than 91% of our chemical weapons stockpile of Category 1 chemical agents, munitions, and containers. We've also completed destruction operations at 7 of our 9 chemical weapons destruction facilities. We have spent to date more than $30.7 billion destroying our chemical weapons, and we continue to make significant progress toward the complete destruction of our remaining stockpile. Now, this map that you see here shows the locations of our declared chemical weapons storage sites and the status of the associated destruction facilities. The 7 locations highlighted in green have completed destruction of their chemical weapon stockpiles. 1 location highlighted in yellow, the Bluegrass facility located in Richmond, Kentucky, is currently working through what we call systemization. The other stockpile site highlighted in light green, the Pueblo, Colorado facility, near Pueblo, Colorado, began operations on the 7th of September, 2016. This next chart shows our progress for stockpile destruction during the reporting period, and we have indeed made significant progress. Since the reporting period in the slide here ended, as of Saturday, the 17th of November, the latest data I have, we have destroyed an additional 48 problematic munitions at the Pueblo Chemical Agent Destruction Pilot Plant, as we call it, explosive destruction system. And the Pueblo Chemical Agent Destruction Pilot Plant has destroyed an additional 6,076 155 millimeter mustard projectiles. In addition, at the Viola, Texas Treatment Storage and Disposal Facility, which is a non-contiguous extension of the Aberdeen Proving Ground, we've also destroyed an unknown chemical fill with 2 recovered munitions that were destroyed during the previous reporting period. In addition, we destroyed 2 munitions containing unknown chemical fill at the Dugway Proving Ground in Utah. So the total amount of agent destroyed during the reporting period is more than 169 metric tons. The 2 remaining chemical weapons destruction facilities, one located, as I said, in Pueblo, Colorado, and the other in Richmond, Kentucky, are part of our Assembled Chemical Weapons Alternatives, or AQUA, program. The AQUA program was established in 1996 to meet the U.S. Congress's direction to identify and demonstrate alternatives to incineration for chemical weapons destruction. Both sites have selected chemical agent neutralization followed by on-site treatment of the byproduct that we call hydrolysate. The Pueblo, Colorado facility is using biotreatment for the secondary treatment of this hydrolysate. While the Bluegrass facility located in Richmond, Kentucky will use something called the supercritical water oxidation for secondary treatment of the hydrolysate. In addition, explosive destruction technologies are being used for palletized munitions and problematic munitions, which are not suitable for automated processing through the neutralization facilities. The Pueblo site is currently using the explosive destruction system, and the Bluegrass site will use something called the static detonation chamber, or SDC. The U.S. has purchased three of these SDC units at a cost of $69 million to augment and therefore accelerate our operations in Pueblo. The first step in the environmental process is complete now, and we will be briefing the next Executive Council on the status of these static detonation chambers. Now at Pueblo, the explosive destruction system, or EDS, is being used to also augment destruction efforts. The EDS destroys problematic munitions in a safe and efficient manner and operates independently of the main plant inside an environmental enclosure. Items identified as unsuitable for processing through the main plant have been destroyed using EDS during what we call the second campaign, which began on the 25th of June, 2018. As additional munitions are identified, they will be destroyed as part of this second campaign. During the reporting period, we destroyed 241 155 millimeter projectiles, 39 105 millimeter projectiles, and 12 4.2 inch mortars. The pictures to the right in the slide show the munitions being loaded into the EDS and the scrap metal from destruction within the EDS. The Pueblo facility began operations on 7 September 2016, and those operations are ongoing. Destruction is more than 16% complete. The left picture is a picture of the Pueblo facility. The top right picture shows an ordnance technician removing the rear assembly of a 4.2-inch mortar round during the baseline reconfiguration. Reconfigured mortars are transferred back to the Pueblo Chemical Depot for safe storage until the munitions can be processed at the plant itself. The bottom right picture that's shown shows a 155-millimeter projectile traveling on a conveyor after thermal treatment by the Munitions Treatment Unit, or MTU as we call it. The MTU heats drain munitions to 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit to remove any residual mustard agent. Now, this slide is an illustration of the destruction process being used at Pueblo. The mustard agent is drained from the projectiles and chemically neutralized by hydrolysis. The resulting hydrolysate is then biotreated in a manner very similar to the way sewage is treated in wastewater treatment facilities. Energetics removed from the munitions are transported to our Anniston Army Depot in Alabama, where they are destroyed using SDC, or the static detonation chamber I previously mentioned. Now at the Bluegrass facility, the static detonation chamber shown in the picture will be used to destroy the entire stockpile of Bluegrass's 15,492 mustard-filled munitions in a safe, environmentally sound manner. SDC construction now stands at 98% complete, while its systemization, which in effect is just a testing of the system, is at 89% complete. I should mention that we also hosted the technical secretariat at an initial visit this October at the Bluegrass facility. We conducted a tour of the site and a review of the facility agreement and the agreed detailed plan for verification of the destruction of chemical weapons was also discussed during that visit. Now, this photo is a view of the Bluegrass facility. Construction at the Bluegrass main plant is complete, and its systemization stands at 70% complete. Systemization activities are currently focused on commissioning of the air monitoring system, the surrogate testing of the metal parts treater, various equipment testing and systems commissioning in both the yard area at the site and the supercritical water oxidation processing building, as well as development of analytical methods in the co-located laboratory. During the current systemization process, more than 1,200 people will be hired, receive training, and achieve certifications required to run the plant. Destruction operations can begin only when the systemization process is complete and the plant and personnel are certified to run the plant. This slide illustrates the process for the main bluegrass plant that will destroy the nerve agent stockpile. Specifically, robotic equipment will remove the energetic components from the rockets. Nerve agent projectiles at bluegrass do not have energetics, so they will skip that particular step. Robotic equipment will then drain the agent from the warheads and projectiles. The agent and energetics will be neutralized, and the agent will be mixed with additional water and a caustic solution forming the hydrolysate. Bluegrass will use the supercritical water oxidation, or SQO as we call it, to process the hydrolysate. The SQO system will subject the hydrolysate to very high temperatures and pressures, breaking the chemicals down into carbon dioxide, water, and salts. The treatment of the munition body and metal parts will be the same process as at Pueblo. Heating the metal parts to 1,000 degrees centigrade, Fahrenheit, or 538 degrees centigrade, for 15 minutes, followed by recycling. Now, my office has begun planning for the next EC visit to the Pueblo site in the spring of 2019, probably would be in April of next year, where we will demonstrate our steady, measurable progress toward the complete destruction of our stockpile. So, in conclusion, the United States is on track to meet our planned completion date. I want to reaffirm again our commitment of the United States to destroy all of our chemical weapons as quickly as practical, while placing the safety of our workers, our citizens, and the environment as our top priority. Mr. Chairman, that concludes my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the presentation. Is there any comments? Any questions or comments? Iran, you have a floor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. We noted the report on the destruction of the chemical weapons stockpile of a state party. As we have stated before, indeed, it was the memory of the victims of the horrific chemical attacks in Iran and in Halabja of Iraq that inspired the conclusion of the Chemical Weapons Convention in 1992. As a result of the implementation of the convention, almost 96% of all declared chemical weapon stockpiles have been destroyed. We would like to appreciate those state parties that completed destruction of their stockpiles on time. By that, the United States remains the only possessor state party that has not yet completed the destruction of its chemical weapons stockpile, while in view of the international experts, it has all the necessary financial and technical capacities to do so. We urge it to take every necessary step to comply with its obligation under the convention without delay. I thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, the Iranian delegation. Now, Russian Federation, you have a floor.
Thank you, Chairperson, for giving me the floor. Our delegation wholeheartedly associates itself with the comments just made by our Iranian colleague with respect to the assessment of the destruction program in the United States. In this case, I have a question to the distinguished colleague from the defense, Department of Defense of the US on this report. And it was a question coming from our national bodies, having read the report of the US authorities on the destruction. This question came up, and I'd like to have an answer. In this report, it says that Dugway plant shells were found with an unknown chemical fill or filling, and we would like to have some comments from the representative of the U.S. delegation. What is an unknown chemical fill? What does it mean? In accordance with the Chemical Weapons Convention, there is no such concept. And why is it not possible to identify what this shell is filled with? What chemical substances were used to fill it? What is the hurdle? What's the obstacle here? And why is it being described in this case, in this fashion? Thank you.
Can you now answer the question from the Russian Federation delegation?
Thank you very much, and I guess I should have introduced myself. My name is Guy Roberts. I'm the Assistant Defense Secretary of Defense for Nuclear, Chemical, and Biological Defense Programs in the U.S. Department of Defense. I can't believe I forgot my own name. With regard to these munitions, in many cases, because of the state of those, and some of these munitions go back to World War I or prior to World War I, and for the many years after, they are, in many cases, environmentally unsound, dangerous, difficult to make or ascertain the nature of the fill. And so under those circumstances, we basically destroy them on the assumption that they have a chemical agent in them, but we don't take the steps to go forward and perhaps identify what exactly agent it might be, whether it be a mustard or some other agent. So we've identified them and characterized them as chemical weapons, and therefore we've destroyed them on the assumption they are, but without delineating necessarily, because of the danger or environmental issues, what exactly is in them. Thank you.
Thank you for your answer. Then United States of America.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. A technical expert we have on the delegation was able to add one thought to what the Assistant Secretary just explained. The weapon was found buried in soil, and rather than risk environmental issues by removing it, it was exploded in place. We put explosives in and blew it up. And essentially, that explosion breaks down all the molecules. So you really don't necessarily know what you have left. But it's a very effective way for destroying something that is in too hazardous a condition to actually remove. So we knew it was a chemical agent. But once the explosives were used to destroy it and neutralize those chemicals, it was no longer possible to determine what the original chemical fill would have been. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ambassador. Now there is no any request release. So thank you for your. China. Yes, I found that the China is now raising her hand. Yeah, China, you have a floor.
To the conference that the issue of the destruction of the abandoned chemical weapons. So can I take the floor now later, or at a later stage?
It's a little late. I'll give the floor to you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. So thank you, Mr. Secretary, for the presentation to this session. Thank you. Is the conference now ready to consider and note the national paper by the United States of America entitled Report to the 23rd session of the Conference of State Parties on progress achieved towards the complete destruction, 31st October 2018, C-23/NAT.1, dated 8th November 2018. So no objection, so noted. We move now to paragraph 8.5 of the annotated provisional agenda. May take it that the conference is now ready to consider and note annual report by the Director General on overall progress with respect to the destruction of the remaining chemical weapons stockpiles C-23/DG.15, dated 14 November 2018. I see no objection. So noted. Now, go back to the issue of the abandoned chemical weapons. I understand that China and Japan have jointly submitted to the Technical Secretariat draft report, the language on the abandoned chemical weapons issue. This language will be reflected in the draft report of this session, which you will see on the screen once we proceed the consideration of the report later. At this moment, point, would any of the two delegations to take the floor to explain to the delegates? Yes. So China, you have a floor.
Mr. Chairman, distinguished delegates, the Chinese delegation would like to take this opportunity to brief the Council on the progress of the destruction of Japanese HWs. In 2018, with the joint efforts made by China and Japan, some progress has been made in the destruction of Japanese HWs. The destruction facility at Harbaling, which hosts the largest burying ground of Japanese HWs, has officially entered into the stage of destruction. The construction of the mobile destruction facility in Harbin was already completed last October, and the facility is scheduled to start its operation next year. And the site selection of the mobile destruction facilities in Taiyuan and Guangzhou is in progress. With regards to excavation and recovery, over 1,000 pieces of Japanese HWs have been unearthed and recovered this year in the cities of Jiangmusi, Shangzhi, Mudanjiang in Heilongjiang province. In addition, more than 600 items of Japanese HWs, which were recovered in the cities of Jiangmusi, Ning'an, and Yueyang, have been identified and overpacked. This year, many more burial locations of Japanese HWs have been found, including those in Bei'an City and Qixihar City in Heilongjiang Province, Jiujiang in Jiangxi Province, and Dangyang in Hubei Province. They were all accidentally discovered by locals during destruction projects. Luckily, no serious casualties and environmental pollution were caused. During Japanese HW excavation and recovery operations in Mudanjiang City, there was found some 1,000 cubic meters of soil containing an excess of total content of arsenic, and they have not yet been effectively treated. China wishes to emphasize that despite the progress in the destruction, there is yet a long way to go before Japanese HWs are completed and thoroughly destroyed. China urges Japan to work earnestly as required by the relevant decision to increase its human and material inputs and complete the destruction as early as possible in accordance with the convention and in line with the timeframes approved by the Executive Council. China will, as always, provide its appropriate cooperation. Meanwhile, China also calls on the Conference of States Parties to act as a policy review organ, pay more attention to the destruction of Japanese SWs, and play its monitoring role. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Chinese delegation. The Japanese delegation, you wanted to take the floor? So, yes, Japan, you have a floor.
Thank you very much for the chairperson to give us an occasion to make some words responding to the Chinese statement on the abandoned chemical weapons. As the Chinese delegation already explained, Japan and China have tackled together a number of challenges and achieved significant progress despite the extremely difficult conditions on which this unprecedented project is conducted. Based on the destruction plan agreed between Japan and China, Japan has been doing the best possible efforts for completing the destruction as soon as possible while appreciating appropriate cooperation by China. We will continue our efforts to fulfill obligations under the convention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Japanese delegation. Next is the agenda item 20, reports of subsidiary bodies. First is a report by the Committee of the Whole. I'd like to give the floor now to the chairperson of the Committee of the Whole, Her Excellency Ambassador Sophia Honor Sam of Ghana. You have the floor, Madam Ambassador.
Delegates, this is to report that during this session of the conference, no items had been allocated to the Committee of the Whole. I believe this can be reflected in the report. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Ambassador, for your report. Next is a report by the General Committee. As the chairperson of the General Committee, I'd like to report to the conference that the General Committee met once throughout the session of the conference and considered the various operational matters. In my capacity as the chairperson of this committee, I informed the conference about these recommendations, which has been endorsed by the conference. I believe that this can be reflected in the report. Thank you. Now, we move now to agenda item 21, the follow-up to the third review conference. In paragraph 9.17 of this report, the third review conference expressed its intention to keep the declaration contained in the paragraph 9.3 to 9.16 of that document under review at each regular session of the conference. Subsequently, the agendas of the Council from its 73rd through 89 sessions have included an item on the follow-up to the third review conference. The conference is now requested to note the activities in furtherance of its review of the declarations contained in paragraph 9.3 to 9.16 of the report of the third review conference EC 989/S/2, dated 19 September 2018. Are there any comments? I see no objection, so noted. Distinguished the delegates, we move now to agenda item 22. Any other business? Would any delegation like to take the floor under this agenda item? Yeah, we need some time. Burundi, you have a floor.
Je vous remercie de m'accorder la parole.
Thank you for giving me the floor. Mr. Chairman, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to deliver a statement on behalf of the following countries: Angola, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Belarus, Bolivia, Burundi itself, China, the Comoros, Congo, Cuba, Russian Federation, Islamic Republic of Iran, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Mozambique, Myanmar, Nicaragua, Uzbekistan, Pakistan, the State of Palestine, the Syrian Arab Republic, the Democratic Republic of Congo, the Democratic People's Republic of Laos, Tajikistan, the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela, Vietnam, and Zimbabwe. Mr. Chairman, we, the states parties to the Convention for the Prohibition Manufacturing, stocking, and use of chemical weapons and their destruction, the Convention, deeply committed to the goals of freeing the world of chemical weapons, firmly condemn the use of chemical weapons by whomsoever in any place and in under any circumstances. We commend the contribution of the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons and the ridding of this type of weapon of massive destruction. We emphasize that the integrity and the universality of the Convention are of crucial importance, both for the Convention, the goal of the Convention, and for maintaining peace and international security. We feel that the inviolability of the fundamental provisions of the Convention, as well as the operating principles of the OPCW, its main bodies and executive bodies, such as the Conference of States Parties, the Executive Council, and the Technical Secretariat of the OPCW, are a vital preconditioning to the proper running of the OPCW as one of the most effective multilateral mechanisms in the field of disarmament and the non-proliferation of weapons of mass destruction. We believe that the decision taken at the fourth extraordinary session of the conference on the 27th of June 2018, namely to endow the Technical Secretariat with to entrust it with authority that is not provided for under the Convention, as well as the proposals of the administrative body of the OPCW to assume the required duties to identify the perpetrators of the use of chemical weapons, goes beyond the remit of the OPCW and the scope of the Convention. These decisions and major proposals, given the purely technical nature of the OPCW, must be considered exclusively under Article 15 of the Convention. The divisions between states parties due to the politicization of the issues arising from the use of chemical weapons significantly reduce the effectiveness of our organization's work because it prevents us from focusing on common tasks which are truly urgent and are defined in the convention and have been successfully implemented for so many years. Mr. Chairman, we call on the states parties to the convention to cooperate constructively and to restore the spirit of consensus and equality within the OPCW in order to preserve the integrity and the universality of the convention. We wish that this document, this statement, be considered an official document of this session of the conference. And thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Vice Chairperson, the Madam Ambassador. Now, Russian Federation, you have a floor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. As one of the states parties that associated themselves with this declaration, feel that this is an extremely important document which illustrates our joint concern to the regarding the organization and our concern over the future of this organization. And I would make one clarification regarding the statement. It's in several languages, and we would like the statement to be included amongst the other documents of the conference on the external website of the OPCW. The statement, we will convey the text of the statement in the other languages through the appropriate channel to the Secretariat. Thank you.
Thank you, Russian Federation's delegation. Distinguished delegates, we have now gone through the all agenda items.